in Jerusalem Monday. Today, Guatemala becomes the second country to move its embassy there. What could Israel have done differently to prevent the bloodshed? Joining us now is Jane Harman. She's a former Democratic congresswoman from California and director, president, and CEO of the Wilson Center. Always good to see you.
Gonna miss you on this program, Chris.
That's all right. You can come with me at night. I'll be wearing this every day. Let me ask you this. What could they have done? What's the answer to that question?
Well, start a little earlier. It was Trump who announced early in his administration that he was going to move the embassy. Mm-hmm. That is the law. I voted for it in 1995 and when I was in Congress. It includes waivers, which every president has given, and he did too.
Wait, but hold on. But, let's take a second.
But when he announced it.
Hold on. You gave it because I've been wanting to scratch at this a little bit. Okay, so Bob Dole's running for office. He's seen as not being pro-Israel enough. This law all of a sudden gets promulgated as legislation. It helps him out in some ways, but you guys put these carve-outs in there, which have been exercised by every president,
right,
which seems to show that you didn't really want to move the embassy from where it was in Tel Aviv to Jerusalem. Fair point?
It was a good aspiration. Everyone recognized the facts on the ground. So if you start there, and I would start there, when Trump announced early in his administration that he wanted to move the embassy, I think Bibi was a bit surprised. It wasn't a high priority for Bibi. He later came to embrace it. I think what went wrong here is not moving the embassy. When Trump announced it the second time, I hoped it was part of a bigger plan, this outside-in deal that Jason Greenblatt and Jared Kushner had been working on with the Sunni neighborhood, led by the Saudis, to help the Palestinians get to yes on a deal with defensible borders with Israel. It might be more territory for Israel, it might be different borders, but that was, I think, possible.
Instead, you had Jared Kushner sit at the embassy opening and say the people out there protesting are the problem while they were being killed.
Yeah, well, so, yes, and there is linkage, notwithstanding what Nikki Haley is saying, between the protests and the timing of the move. The Palestinians want to be heard. This is the only way they can be heard. Many of them were unarmed. And did Israel use disproportionate force? I hope not, because I think that's a problem if they did. We don't know all the facts yet. But all I'm saying here is that if this had been handled differently, Trump might have had one of these huge deals that he's seeking. The other one is with North Korea, which may be receding a bit, too. All of this is linked. Getting out of the Iran deal is linked to some of the resentment of Europe now, and Europe's not coming to our aid, and NATO's not coming to our aid. We'll see what happens there after he unilaterally announced that he's pulling out of these Chinese sanctions.
So the two points of pushback are, one, Nikki Haley said the Israeli forces showed restraint. Do you agree with that assessment?
I don't know. Let's see. I mean, 60 deaths is a lot of deaths and thousands of injuries and no hospital capacity to take care of these people. I'm not excusing what they did, and I'm not excusing Hamas. Hamas is a dreadful governor of Gaza.
And relevant here because the theory is that Hamas put these people up to this. They knew that this was a moment. They used their people as pawns to be provocative and often victims as a result. Do they share blame here as well?
Yes, they share blame. But should we have been surprised by this? No. Should we be surprised that Kim Jong-un all of a sudden is making demands? No. And I'm worried about that because I think our intelligence community was surprised.
Well, let's shift to that.
We need to know a lot more.
Why is Jane Harman surprised? Jane Harman is so smart. You've seen this movie with North Korea before. You knew that this is a diplomatic moonshot. You knew that North Korea wouldn't go quietly into that good night. Why are we surprised?
Well, I don't think we should be surprised. I think we should have anticipated this. And if John Bolton made provocative comments on TV, he should have thought about that. I'm not saying he would change, given his views of foreign policy. But if it's in the newspapers, ours, in a couple of articles by David Sanger, who happens to be at the moment a scholar at the Wilson Center, writing a book on cyber.
Is that why you're juicing Sanger so much? We did have him on the show twice already this morning.
Well, he's a more big would be more. Show. He's brilliant. That's why we chose him. But my point is, he's written two articles in the last week. One is about how we are expanding and modernizing our nuclear arsenal as we are asking both Iran and North Korea to disarm theirs. That's one. And the second one is to adequately monitor the denuclearization of North Korea will take hundreds of people, more than the capacity that the IAEA has for the world. And we're going to get into those tunnels and all the rest of it. And Kim is looking at this, you'd think, and thinking, oh, my God, I could end up like Muammar Gaddafi if my own people rise against me.
All right, so, well that's interesting, but it's a little different than what Bolton said. It's one thing for Kim Jong-un to say, boy, when my people, a little bit of the Cuba model, that when my people get a taste of what freedom really is like, I have trouble. Now, it hasn't worked out in Cuba. Who knows what would happen in North Korea? But Bolton seemed to be suggesting it a different way. You give us everything we want, or big bombs are going to come your way, and then you're going to be gone. Because that's what the Libya model is it not?
Well, we caught Libya red-handed. They hadn't built a bomb. There's a huge difference between North Korea, Libya, and Iran. North Korea has up to 60 bombs and very advanced chemical and biological capacity, too. And they've been hiding it for 70 years. And they have a ruthless regime with the worst human rights record
right.
in the world. Tens of thousands of people in gulags. Let's remember that before we call this guy honorable.
Bad regime.
At any rate, my point is that I don't think those threats work there. They've got the bomb. It would be nice to have denuclearization of the world as an aspiration. But I don't think, my personal view, and maybe somebody knows something I don't know, that getting them to give everything up as a precondition to a conversation is any way to start a conversation. It won't happen.
And on the issue of, well, the U.S. is building up its nuclear, the U.S. doesn't have any pledge that is of existential threat to other people in the world, right? That's the difference between the United States and Israel and Iran and North Korea. Look, I stepped into this hole with Bibi Netanyahu when I was pushing him why he won't admit that Israel has nukes when everybody in the intelligence communities all over the world say that they do. And his point was, and it was a fair point, I'm not looking to take anybody out with my nukes. I'm looking to defend myself. The United States would make the same case.
Right.
So do they need the same level of disclosure as an Iran or a North Korea, known inimical states with regimes that have a purpose of destruction?
Well, Israel is a rational actor, and it's a democratic ally, the only truly democratic regime in the Middle East. That makes it very different from Iran, which is threatening the annihilation of Israel,
sure.
or North Korea, which is threatening the annihilation of the United States. I don't think that's an achievable goal, but nonetheless, they have long-range missiles. They don't yet have reentry capacity, which is a good time for us to be negotiating some kind of a containment deal. I'm all for talking to them, and I commend President Trump for focusing on North Korea and making it his first priority.
You think it happens?
But I hope a conversation happens. I'd love something to happen. But I think the two huge deals he could have attained, one is an Israel-Palestine deal made by them but blessed by us in a neighborhood that has changed, and the other is a really good North Korea deal, are receding because we don't link foreign policy moves that we make. We've made enemies of Europe, which I think was a very avoidable mistake. And we, because of the way we moved the embassy, we forced this Sunni neighborhood to oppose it, and we should have predicted that there'd be Palestinian violence.
You know, Jane, I asked you to do too much this morning because this is all interrelated. We need to have you back, and we need to discuss this because the idea of the hopes, the aspirations, and the realities in North Korea, that's complex stuff. It deserves its own time. We'll do that again. Thank you for being here.
Chris,
you always make us better.
I'll miss this show with you.
Well, it'll only get better when I'm gone. Allison?
What about me, Jane?
Yeah, I was going to say, you stepped in one of the classic blunders on New Day.
Hey, you've interviewed me on this show, too. You're great, Allison.
Good recovery.
Okay, thank you, Jane.
And you're back.
Recovery. Good. thank you guys very much. Okay, so the Trump administration exploring potentially holding children who are caught at the border crossing at military bases apart from their parents. So will lawmakers support this plan? We ask a Republican.